Good morning, Life City Church. It is so great to be back with you for another incredible service. I hope you've had a great week. I've had an up and down week, a roller coaster ride, but I am glad to be in church with you. And I just want to give a massive shout out to any of you that are joining us for the first time, or it's your second or third week. We are so happy that you are here with us and part of the LC family. Without further ado, we're going to go into a time of worship. So jump up off your seats and get ready to praise.
Good morning, Life City. Let's jump up to our feet for another Sunday service. We're so excited you've tuned in with us this morning. Let's jump up off the sofa.
I was going down, thought it was for the count. Then I found your love. I had wandered off, thought I had gone too far. There I found your love. I used to know, can't stop me anymore, 'cause I found your love. When I feel alone, I have a place to go, 'cause I found your love. Great was the debt of sin, grace brought me back.
Say
singing over me. You have been so, so good to me. I took a breath, you breathed your life in me. You have been so, so
Nothing else will do. We just
just want you. Oh, I just want you. Nothing else. Nothing else. Nothing else will do. We just want you. Nothing else. Nothing else.
Come on, church, sing this out this morning. We want nothing else but him. We want nothing else this morning. We want to chase after him this morning. There's nothing else that will satisfy, nothing else that will fill us up this morning. Father, we love you. We thank you, Father. We yearn, we long for you this morning, Father. We pray for an encounter, Father, in every home, Father, that is meeting here right now, Father. We pray for a fresh encounter, Father, nothing else but you.
Hi Life City, I know that the majority of you have probably seen me around, or maybe you've never been introduced to me, but my name's Sarah, and as you've probably seen, I usually play the keys, but today I'm here to give you guys an inspiration. So the verse that I'd chosen actually was Romans 8:32 in the NLT version, which says, "Since he did not spare even his own son, but gave him up for all of us, won't he also give us everything else?" And I wanted to focus this inspiration on just how much God cares about our individual needs. I know we have so much going on in terms of how much tension there is right now, also with this pandemic, but God cares so much about your individual needs and your desires. Sometimes even the things you pray for, other times the things that you weren't even praying about, he still cares for. And I definitely get to experience that in my life with my family and friends. And over these past few weeks, I've been really thinking about how much more I can be attentive to how God wants to use me to care for the people around me. I'd been recently reading this book by Tim Ross, all about upsetting other people's worlds, and that's essentially just being that much more observant to the Holy Spirit, kind of wanting you to do things for other people, to just show God that he cares for each other, for each one of us, by doing things, by saying things, by commenting on things that people wouldn't have normally picked up. And I really just wanted to just reaffirm and reassure all of you that God cares so much about your individual needs. God cares so much about what you think about, the things that you may not tell other people, you know, because he's around you in those spaces where other people aren't. And he wants to be able to keep showing you and reaffirming you how much he cares for you. I'm sure that if he could make every single stranger you walk past stop and compliment you on that one thing that you were feeling so insecure about, he would. But it takes us as Christians having to be so open to wanting to be those vessels that God uses it through. And there is just nothing in God's eyes that he doesn't care about. It doesn't matter how big or how small. Yes, we're in a pandemic, but your individual matters are so crucial to God. Yes, we're in such a tense time right now, but the fact that you almost lost your car keys mean just as much to God as it did to you. And so I really just wanted to give you that just extra affirmation, you know. Even me giving this inspiration right now is just God wanting you to just be reaffirmed and to just know that he is thinking about you, and that, you know, there is just nothing you have to worry about and think you can put aside just because of everything that's happening around you. So I'm glad that I had this chance to speak to this inspiration to you guys, and I hope you guys have a blessed week and you continue to try with me to just be open to seeing how God cares about you, you know. That one YouTube video you were recommended on your timeline, that wasn't a coincidence. That stranger that bumped into you to just tell you what they thought about you, that you looked really amazing that day and that you were doing a great job, that wasn't a coincidence. And for us also being open as Christians to being those people for other people. So thank you guys.
Thank you. What an absolutely incredible inspiration from Sarah there. Really love seeing some of the YA come and step up and share their voice and their thoughts. And just such a powerful theme, you know, just remembering and reminding ourselves that God cares, even when there's so many things going on. He's there. He will never leave us nor forsake us. And He deeply and truly cares about you. So many of you are going to be wondering what will be happening with church restarting. And so to give us a little update on that, we have Pastor Steve.
Good morning, Life City. Just want to take a few moments to talk to you about our physical return to Sunday church. So excited that we're in a position, even in the midst of all of this restriction, in the midst of all of the things that are happening in our society with coronavirus, praise God that we have an opportunity as a church to still come together and meet. We had a very successful meeting with Woodcote School just in the recent week, and they are in a position now where they're ready to begin to re-let to outside organizations such as ourselves. And that means from sometime, probably around in the middle of October, we are looking to restart physical services. But that is going to mean a few changes in the light of government restrictions, in the light of what's happening with coronavirus. It means that our services are going to look different. It means that when you come, you're not going to have any time to be able to socialize over a tea and a coffee. And I know that's a big part of our church, but it's something we're not going to be able to offer at this time. You're going to have to book in via our app, because we're going to need to know who's going to be coming on any given Sunday. And we need to prepare, obviously, the venue to be able to seat people and to make sure that they're socially distanced. When you come, you're going to have to wear a mask. You're going to have to be temperature checked. You're going to have to be able to do track and trace, whether you use the NHS app or whether that information that we take as you book in will be kept, so that if there's any kind of outbreak, then people will be able to be informed. It means at the end of our service, you're going to have to leave pretty promptly. Because of the rule of six, you're not going to be able to congregate in groups larger than six, but you will be able to spend some time talking to one another outside in the grounds of the school. You might think, well, this is a lot of restrictions, and it is, but you know, I really want to encourage you that it's time for us to come back together. It's time for us to, gather ourselves on a Sunday. And you might be a little bit anxious or a little bit fearful of that, but I want to encourage you that, you know, we've got to step forward, not just in the practicalities, not just ensuring that we can provide a safe environment, but step forward knowing that as a church we need to come together. More information will be coming out. We'll be giving you further updates so you're absolutely sure what is happening. But I just wanted to let you know that we are getting ready to come back together, and we want you to be part of that, because I believe that we are strong together. Yeah, we are better together. And when we can physically be together, we can worship together, we can hear the word together, that builds something in our Christian life. So we will keep you updated, keep you informed, but we will see you very soon.
So we're going to give an opportunity for the offering now. And my verse is Proverbs 15:16. Better to have little with fear for the Lord than to have great treasure and inner turmoil. And I recently started as an English teacher, and this entire term we've been looking at Macbeth. And Macbeth, part of the whole thematic theme of the play is that Macbeth has inner turmoil. He has chaos inside his mind because he has gone and seized the throne. He's gone and found this great treasure, but he corrupts and ruins himself on the inside. And I guess this can translate to us, is when we're focusing on great treasure, whether it be great wealth or some great ambition that we're focusing on, we're not giving that time and that needed fear for the Lord. We're not giving that time to our faith, because there are other things that we have a greater ambition for, that we put over God. We have gods of our own sense, whether that's money, your career, your status in society. But it is better to have little, to be content with what you have. And part of how we do that is through our giving, saying that there is nothing above you, God. And I am showing you that by giving my 10%, my tithe to you each week, and I remain faithful to you. So let's just pray over that right now. So let's just pray over that. Lord, I pray that we would remain faithful to you, that we would have no God other than you, and that we would remain faithful with our giving, showing that we have no ambition, no greater treasure than you, and that we come humbly before you. And we just pray that we would always put you first in everything that we do. Amen.
Hey, Life City, so good to be with you again. And just reflecting on that inspiration from Ezra last week, I know for many of you, it really spoke to you, really spoke into your situations. And I think for me, it really just gave me some time to reflect on a number of things that Ezra was talking about, you know, that whole idea about how Psalm 23 was written as a sort of call for refreshing, a time where God will just take us aside to allow us to refocus and be refreshed and get ourselves into a place ready to go again. And the reason Psalm 23 was written is because so often we can find ourselves in the midst of struggles. You only need to read some of the other Psalms to realize how often, you know, people found themselves in the midst of struggles where they were crying out to God. And Ezra mentioned about God doing a deep work in people's lives. And that kind of really led me to think about that song by Hillsong called New Wine. We've sung it many times at the church. But it opens with this line. It says, in the crushing, in the pressing, you're making new wine. And I think God is always trying to do something new in your life and in my life. But that doesn't mean it's always easy. It doesn't mean that we find ourselves in situations or circumstances or things that are happening, you know, in our life that are always easy. There can be a sense of pressure that comes around our life that can cause all sorts of output and responses from us. I began to think about the whole idea of grapes. You know, they're grown to be crushed. You look out on the vineyards in France or California or wherever else around the world, and those grapes are grown specifically to be crushed, because it's the crushing that eventually transforms into wine. And I think there is something about understanding that the pressure that can sometimes come to our lives can do something of God's work in us and through us that causes new wine, if you want to put it that way, to flow from us. We love talking about the breakthroughs and the successes, but we don't speak much about our struggles or our stressful times. And the reason for that is because, you know, when we do talk about them, people do struggle to listen or to sometimes connect with us, or we can seem like we're whining or we're being negative. But, you know, there are realities that surround our lives, your life and my life. You know, we're not always talking about the stresses of job redundancy at the moment, or the fact that a business may have collapsed, or the fact that our marriage is struggling, or we're battling sickness, or we're fighting loneliness, or we're working three jobs to pay the bills. We're not always talking about those things. We kind of keep them to ourselves. But, you know, there are times of crushing, times of pressure that can come around our lives. But, you know, I already believe that God is able to use them to produce something, transform them into something that can flow out of our lives, that can be so sweet and so precious, that it can build his kingdom. And I kind of want to speak today, a message called the crushing season. I think that, you know, the idea of crushing is a difficult one for us. But, you know, it's something that I think that we can find ourselves at seasons of our life. Crushing's hard because it takes something in us to produce something from us. I'll say that again. Crushing is hard sometimes because it takes something in us to produce something from us. I've often thought about my own life, and there's a certain tenacity that people have said that I have, you know, that I'm quite tenacious. It means that I don't easily give up and I kind of keep going when the pressure's on. But, you know, it doesn't just arrive. You know, you just don't have tenacity one day because you didn't have it yesterday. It's something that's grown through the pressure, of life's crushings. You know, I think about the Apostle Paul, and he said this. He said, I know what it is to be abased, and I know what it is to abound. Yeah, he knew both sides of that coin. He had a perspective on both sides. And his spiritual perspective informs us that there are times, that what we're going through, what we're experiencing is not the final outcome. Yeah, I think there are times when we realize that we can find ourselves sometimes in difficult situations, but it doesn't mean that our whole life is going to be like that. You know, God is more than able, to come and to move in our life. And we've been looking at faith factors over the last few weeks, you know, and when we exercise faith in our life, it means that we can overcome and find a way through these pressure times around our life. I want to use the example of Joseph. He's an interesting figure in the Bible. We find him in the book of Genesis from chapter 37 through to chapter 50. And it's interesting because God had a purpose for his life. Joseph was the 11th son of Jacob and Rachel. And he was favored by his dad. His dad loved him, made him a coat of many colors. You may have ever seen the musical. And it's interesting because there was a call, yeah, on Joseph's life that was going to be absolutely amazing. He was going to save a nation. And yet what he had to transition through in his life could actually be seen at many times as a crushing season. It maybe just even wasn't one crushing season. You know, it started with dreams. Joseph had these dreams. He had dreams of grain. You know, his brothers collected grain and his parents collected grain. And all of their sheaves of grain bowed down to his sheaf of grain. He had another dream where, you know, there was the sun and the moon and there were some stars. And they all bowed before him. And you would have thought, wow, these dreams are amazing. You know, well, what's God trying to do? But, you know, all it really produced for his life at that time was jealousy. His brothers got jealous, didn't like him very much. In fact, that jealousy moved on and they sold him into slavery. We think, wow, you know, God's got this purpose, but all I've got so far is rejection from my family and now they've sold me into slavery. And in fact, if you want to go further than that, if you want to really look at the crushing season that was around Joseph's life, yeah, he ends up in prison at one point. Yeah, all before the manifestation of this purpose that God has for his life. You see, the timing that we sometimes find ourselves in is very dependent on our perspective and our position. You know, we can look sometimes and think, God, why is this happening to me? Yeah, why is this pressure around my life? Why is there so much that's going on, yeah, that I don't like? I'm not, you know, feeling, I don't like the vibe of it. Yeah, I don't know even sometimes how to move through it. Yeah, you know, where are you? What's going on? It's like we feel that our prayers aren't being answered, that God almost isn't interested in our life. But, you know, the timing of God really depends on where you are positioned and how you are looking at something. You see, when you're standing in the shadow of the valley of the shadow of death, everything feels like it's surrounding you and about to overwhelm you. Yeah, when you're going through that valley of the shadow of death, it looks not good. It looks like things are going to topple down on you. But God says, don't fear. I'm here. Yeah, my rod and my staff will give you comfort. There's a song that we sing called Surrounded. You know, the tagline says, it may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. There's those times when you think that those things that are coming against you are going to overwhelm you, but you know, God is there. God is surrounding you. He is your shield. Yeah, he is your protector. Yeah, don't fear a shadow. A shadow can't harm you. It can't stop you. It can't hold you back. The valley isn't a dwelling place. Yeah, it's a testing ground. It's an interesting one. It's not a dwelling place. I know people, sometimes you talk to them, it's like they've been in the valley of the shadow of death for so long, they've almost camped there. It's like they don't think there's a way out. They don't think there's a way forward. But it's a testing ground. When you find yourself in that crushing time, when the pressures around you seem so overwhelming, yeah, it's a testing of who you'll draw close to. Who will you put your trust in? Who will you rely upon? I can think about the testimony of my own life at times. You know, I've experienced, yeah, like many others, yeah, those times of crushing in my life, those times when things just didn't seem to be going the right way, when, you know, it seemed like everything I was hoping for, believing for, yeah, trying to trust God for, it was almost like going in the wrong direction. I remember a time in a church I was part of where 8 years of my life just seemed to go by in obscurity. You know, nobody was talking about the gifting on my life. Nobody was talking about God's purpose in my life. In fact, people were pretty much, you know, very disinterested and didn't think I had much to offer. And yet there was something on the inside that felt that God wanted to do something. See, that comes back to your position and your perspective of what you think God is doing. But, you know, when I look back at that time and I felt, yeah, like, hey, what's the point? What's the point of trying to be part? What's the point of trying to move into ministry? What's the point of trying to do this when nobody is interested? Yet when I seemed totally hidden to everybody, yet I began to realize that really what was happening was I was in a time of preparation. I was in the cocoon of God's preparation. You know, there are times when God puts us in a position where nobody sees us, but he knows we're there. It's like nobody recognizes us, but he recognizes we're there. It's like when nobody says, what's in you is great, God's saying, I've placed it in you, and there's a time, and there's a purpose, and there's a reason, and a season for what's going to flow out of you. You see, when Joseph was in prison, he talked to people, he interpreted dreams for those who were also in prison with him. And when they got out, they said they would speak for him, but when they got out, they forgot him. Have you ever felt forgotten? Have you ever had people around you who said they would speak up for you? Yeah, who would be there for you? Yeah, who would bring their friendship or bring their love or bring whatever? Yeah, and in the moment you needed them, they weren't there. It's like you were forgotten. I want to say God doesn't forget you. God doesn't forsake you. He doesn't leave you. He created you for a reason. He loves you. He's got a purpose for your life. And when you find yourself in a pressure time, in a crushing season, you've got to rely on the fact that God knows you, God loves you, God is there for you. People may abandon you, but God will never leave you. Psalm 23, so much is about, he is our shepherd. He is the one who guides us. He's the one who is there for us. He's the one who makes us lie down in difficult times. It's interesting because I was doing a little bit of study on the temple of God. And you know, in the temple, they put showbread on a table in a certain part of the temple. It was there for a particular reason. It was the representation, 12 loaves representing the tribes of Israel. It speaks of God's provision and God's blessing in difficult times. But you know, the showbread that was placed there was made of the finest flour. You know, you and I now, we can go out and we can buy, you know, fine flour and we can make bread should we choose. But if you wanted to make fine flour to make showbread, you had to, yeah, grind it down. You had to crush it down until it was fine enough that you could use it. And I want you to know that there are times when God is at work in our lives where he's taken what is rough and he's grinding it down to make it fine so he can make something that will flow, yeah, and come forth from our life. And I think sometimes people say, well, is it God doing this? Is it, you know, is God bringing this upon me? I want to tell you, there's enough trouble in the world at times. There's enough trouble with sometimes the decisions that we make, yeah, that cause pressure times. But in all of those things, God is able to use what is happening. He can work all things for your good and for my good. See, crushing isn't the end. It's a stage, yeah, that has potential to bring the best out of our lives. It's not an end point. Sometimes we feel that nothing's ever going to change. It will. Sometimes we feel there's no way out. There is. And we've got to come to that place where we realize that if we're in a crushing season, yeah, God is more than able. Where are you going to put your faith? Where are you going to put your trust? What are you going to believe in? Yeah, how are you going to stand? How are you going to speak? Because it might feel that it's never going to end, but there will always be an end point. And so the question comes then, all right, Steve, that's great, but how do we deal with these seasons of crushing? Well, I think one of the best ways is to trust God's word. What we need to do so often is we need to cultivate the ground of our heart to receive its seeds. It's the word of God that helps you. It's the word of God that frees you. It's the word of God that sustains you in the crushing season. You see, your tests and trials don't define you, they transform you. This is what James talks about, you know, in his book. He says, look, the trials that you have, they have the potential to perfect your faith. And so we get to this place, yeah, when we look at Joseph, and you're wondering why he's not mentioned any scripture. Well, I'm coming to it right now. His life was, yeah, a long crushing season. From the time he was rejected by his brothers, they sold him into slavery. He ends up, you know, serving in a house. He ends up in a prison. 10 years he spent in that prison. Can you just imagine 10 years of your life just gone like that, waiting? But here's the thing, that God always has a way. God always has a purpose and God always has a reason, and his timing is always perfect. And this is Joseph. I'm going to read from Genesis 45. I'm going to pick up verse 3. This is Joseph, and he's talking to his brothers now. He's kind of revealed who he is. They thought he was long dead and gone, and yet here he is as the second most important person in Egypt, and he is saving not only a nation but his family. And this is what he says. He says, I am Joseph, he said to his brothers. Is my father still alive? But his brothers were speechless. They were stunned to realize that Joseph was standing there in front of them. Please come closer, he said to them. So they came closer. And he said again, I am Joseph, your brother, whom you sold into slavery in Egypt. But don't be upset and don't be angry with yourselves for selling me to this place. And notice what he says here, because this is where the new wine starts coming. This is where the revelation, yeah, that pours into his life, realizes that everything that he's experienced was for a purpose. It says, it was God who sent me here ahead of you to preserve your lives. This famine has ravaged the land for 2 years. It will last 5 more years, and there will be neither plowing nor harvesting. God has sent me ahead of you to keep you and your families alive and to preserve many survivors. So it was God who sent me here, not you. And he is the one who made me an advisor to Pharaoh, the manager of his entire palace and the governor of all Egypt. You see, I think there comes a place when we realize that we may be in a crushing season, but it's for a purpose that God can always begin to use. And that song that says, in the crushing and the pressing, there's new wine. I don't know about you, but I kind of want new wine to flow from my life. I may experience in times to come, a crushing season around my life where pressure comes about me, yeah, but it's never going to overcome me. You see, when we look at Jesus, we see the ultimate example. In fact, we see the ultimate example of what it is to be crushed. The cross is Christ's place of crushing. It's a place, yeah, where he gave absolutely everything for you and me, but it's a place of transformation. It was not a final destination. You see, when you see pictures of the cross, or you're going to churches and you see a cross with Christ on, that isn't an accurate representation. Christ isn't there anymore. Neither is he in a tomb. He gave his life. His life was crushed. He became the sin of the world for you and me so that we could know the life that he so wonderfully showed us when he walked on this planet. And Christ isn't there any longer. He's not on a cross. That was a place, yeah, of transformation. And we can come to Christ. We can come to the cross knowing that he gave his life, that his life was crushed, so that you and I could drink the new wine of God's eternal life. Christ endured the ultimate crushing as the sin of the world to provide a pathway to freedom, to connection, a new life that can be found in God. And you can experience that today. We're going to pray soon. And we'll pray a prayer where you can receive Jesus into your life if you wish. You see, I want to talk to you right now. If you're enduring a crushing season, I want you to know that there is something new that's going to be produced. I found this scripture. It's a prophetic scripture in the book of Amos. It really spoke to my life. I hope it speaks to you. I kind of want to share it with you. From Amos 9 and verse 13 and 14, it says this: the time will come, says the Lord. I want to speak it out prophetically to you. If you're going through a crushing season, this is a word for you. The time will come, says the Lord, when the grain and the grapes will grow faster than they can be harvested. Then the terraced vineyards on the hills of Israel will drip with sweet wine. I will bring my exiled people of Israel back from distant lands, and they will rebuild their ruined cities and live in them again. For some of us, this pandemic has felt like an exile from many things. For many of us, you may have gone through a crushing season during this pandemic time. But I want you to know that that which is being grown in you, that which I suppose in some respects has been pressed and crushed, yeah, sweet wine is going to come from it. You're going to see God's best, yeah, flowing not only to you, but from you. And that which has been broken down will be reestablished in your life. That which has been robbed away from you, God will restore. And I want you to know and have confidence that whatever season you've gone through, whatever crushing of your experience, whatever has come and surrounded your life, there is new wine ahead of you. Come on, why don't you stand to your feet? We're going to pray right now. Father, I thank you right now for those who have stood, for those, Lord, who have been through a crushing season. Father, I'm going to pray, Lord, that you would speak into their hearts and lives. For those who have struggled in relationships, Lord, for those who have gone where they've felt rejection, Lord, for those who have been lonely, for those who felt the pressure of the collapse of their life of business, Lord, that they have struggled to try and keep afloat, Lord. For those, Lord, who have really just lost the respect, Lord, of people around them, Lord. For those, Lord, who felt that, Lord, that nobody's interested in them, that they have nothing more to offer. Lord, Father, I pray now, Lord, that you would reveal yourself, Lord, that they would see, Lord, that everything that's happened to them, everything they've been surrounded by, everything that's come to try and pressure them or crush them, Lord, in the name of Jesus, Lord, Father, I declare, Lord, that you can turn that around. You can bring a way forward, or you can provide a doorway, Lord, Father. You can bring and transform all of that, Lord, and see a new wine flowing out, Lord, of people's lives. Father, I pray in faith that they would rise up and trust you, Lord, that they would call upon your name, Lord. Father, that they would look to you, Lord, as the provider, as their supply, Lord, as their shepherd, Lord. Father, that you can guide them and lead them into that new place today in the name of Jesus. Amen. Hey, if you've been watching today and maybe something I've said has really spoken to you or touched your heart, I really want to encourage you that in this moment you can step into a relationship with Jesus Christ. Maybe you've been listening and thinking, wow, there's just something here that's touched my heart. Well, in a moment I'm going to pray a prayer and you can pray after me. And I really believe as you pray it, something's going to be transformed in your heart and in your life. And you're going to come into a relationship with Jesus Christ. Yeah, you're going to come into a relationship with God as your Father. And you're never going to be the same again. You know, pray this prayer with me right now. Lord Jesus, I thank you that you love me. I thank you that you gave your life for me. And today, I turn from my sin and I embrace my new life. I thank you that you love me. And from this moment, I will live my life for you. Amen. Hey, if you prayed that prayer today, I already believe that you stepped into a new life. Yeah, transformation is coming about you now. And I really believe that if you just take some time to connect with us, we'd love to speak with you. You'll see a little thing that's going to come up in the chat window here that says, I raise my hand. Why don't you just click on that? Let us know that you responded. Send us a message, send us an email, reach out to us. We'd love to speak to you. Hey, in all things, have a great week.
What a fantastic message from Pastor Steve. I hope that impacted you. We're just going to finish with a worship song. So if you want to jump up off the sofa and lift your hands.
I count on one thing, the same God that never failed will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Oh yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy. All my days, oh yes. Thank you.
What an awesome message from Pastor Steve there. I just absolutely love that. The crushing season, that when you face pressures in your life, these are a place of transformation. They're not your destination. This isn't where we stay. And that God is always with us. He will never leave us. He will never forsake us. And He is propelling us forward into that God-given destiny, that we will come out of the other side as new wine, as fresh people. And just so exciting, such an incredible message. I hope you enjoyed that. I hope that blessed you. And don't forget, come connect in the Connect Lounge. There's a little button just up here that says connect with us. It will be open at the end of the service. And I want to see you there. Some smiling faces, some great conversation. I can't wait. Let's pack it out. Let's get it ready for when we come back in physical presence together. So we'll see you next Sunday at 10:15 for the in-service chat. Have an absolutely awesome week, and I'll see you then.